This talk, Karma and Reincarnation, was given by Sri Sri Ravi Shankar in Santa Monica, California, in January 1997.
Every object in this universe is endowed with four characteristics. They are dharma, karma, prema, and jnana. Dharma means nature. Everything has a definite nature, animate or inanimate object. They have a nature. Monkeys have their nature. Human beings have their nature. In the same way, metals have their nature. Aluminium has its nature. Copper has its nature. Nature is called dharma. And then karma. And there is certain activity, definite activity that is attributed or that comes out of each object. It's easy to say object. It can include also living beings for the time being, for our understanding. Karma. And then the third is prema, means love. There is love in every particle of this creation. Love is attraction. Love means absorbing the viscosity, bringing togetherness. So many atoms, they come together, so a molecule is made or an object is made. A type of molecules or atoms get together, then you say, oh, this is metal, this is iron, this is copper. There is something that holds things together. And this force of bringing things together, holding things together, is called love or prema. Love is present in the entire creation, in every particle of this creation. There is love, and that is how there is reproduction happening. There is love, that is how the planets are moving in their orbits. There is love, that's why the sun is shining, the stars are shining. There is love in every atom, that's why the electron is moving around the charged particle. The charge of attraction, the charge in this entire creation is a power, is love. That's called prema and jnana. Are you all listening to me now? You are listening, right? Who is listening? Who is listening? Who is knowing what I am saying? This something in this body, in your body, 6 feet, 5 feet, 4 feet, 8 inches body. What is knowing in that body? It is the consciousness, isn't it? Are you listening? Are you knowing what is happening here? You think only the little mind or consciousness in your little body alone can know? This knowingness is present also in every particle of creation. How do we know? Only through the head? Only through the senses? No, our entire body has the ability to know. The mind is not just in the head, it is all over the body. See, suppose in a dormitory, say, or you are having a pajama party. Several of you are sleeping in a room and someone calls James. Only James will wake up when you are all asleep. When your name is called and you wake up, not the other person. I mean, if they shout aloud, then everybody will jump out of their bed. But even in sleep, we have an ability to know. And this ability to know is permeating in our entire consciousness. And consciousness is present all over the body. and beyond the body. This is called jnana, the knowingness of the intelligence, or the intelligence in the existence. You might have seen about the touch me not plant. You know, when you go near it, you have not even touched it, it already closes. The plants can feel, they know. In the same way, animals have got their own degree of knowingness. The dog can sense. Birds can sense something that is going to happen. If there is an earthquake, you can hear the birds a few hours earlier making huge noises. Your dogs can feel much earlier than you could feel it. You might have experienced this, isn't it? There is a degree of knowingness present in the entire creation. It varies, like the level of love also varies. See, how much love a dog expresses. Suppose you are out even for a few hours and you come back home and the dog goes crazy, jumps all over the place, jumps on the sofa, jumps on you. He doesn't know what to do. It wants to pour out all its love on you. And it tries to express. It doesn't say, I love you very much. It doesn't say, I can't live without you. But that moment, it just floods you with its innermost feeling of love. In the same way, the plants, the trees in your garden do emit love. They express love to you. You can do this. These are simple things, experiments at home. If you attend to one particular tree and just be with it, don't have to say, write a letter to it or say, I love you. Go chant there, make a rosary, I love you, I love you. Just be in that space near a tree and you will see that growth of the tree is much more. And if you just intend, okay, let the flowers blossom fast, you know, they blossom. There are people sometimes surprised when we have the meditation and satsang and singing and all. The flowers sometimes stay for a whole month. Many people have reported. See, the flowers have stayed for a whole month. It's nothing surprising. It's the law of nature. Love is part of wholeness. It's the nature. It's the love that's the subtlest energy that we all live on. Jnana, the knowingness or knowledge, is the fourth characteristic of any object. Are you all listening? So now, what is karma? We will pick up one of this. Karma, most used and often misunderstood word, karma. What is karma? Karma is action. The literal meaning of karma is action. The action could be latent, could be in the form of tendency, could be a future happening. So there are three types of karma. Prarabdha means the action which is manifest now. You are listening. Are you listening? This is an action. This is manifest now. You wanted to hear this several hours ago. That was a latent karma. So you came back from your work and you said, okay, I'm going to Sheraton Marima to listen to the talk. That thought which came brought you from your home to this place. And this action for a future karma is called Sanchita Karma. The collected karma, the present karma which is running, which is in action, and then the future karma that would happen. After listening to whatever we are discussing here now, you'll go back home and then you might remember or you may totally forget it. This is agami karma, the future karma of this. So the impression in the mind is latent action. It is still action, but it is latent. Just like the memory. A memory is functional now. Other memories are latent within us. You know the mathematical table. But right now you are not memorizing it. But you have memorized it. It is already there. When you need it, it just pops up. Right? Are you getting what I'm saying? You might have studied George Eliot, poem from George. And you know that. And when you want it, then it comes out. or the national anthem. So certain impressions, strong impressions in the mind remains, and they form the future karma. Every habit is a sort of karma. Do you know what I'm saying? Suppose you have been drinking coffee every morning, and one day you don't drink, you get headache. This is coffee karma. Now, how to eliminate coffee karma? Either by drinking it or observing it. Okay, every day I've been drinking nicotine, it's no good for me. Okay, let the headache come for me. Take a Tylenol or do some breathing or meditate, do something or jog. Being aware of a tendency in us will help us to overcome the tendency, or experiencing the tendency, we overcome the tendency. Here is the play of jnana, the knowledge, awareness. Knowledge means not informative knowledge. Here knowledge means awareness, the sense of knowingness. When you increase the sense of knowingness in you, karma gets reduced. All the animals have got only prarabdha karma, means the karma of which they do not have any control. The nature runs them, so they don't accumulate a future karma. If you are like an animal totally, you don't get any karma. But as a human being, this is impossible, because our mind gets into that impression. Now reincarnation is another topic. Reincarnation means coming again into body. Our mind is energy. And by the law of thermodynamics, you know energy cannot be destroyed, right? Third law of thermodynamics. If mind is energy, what happens to this energy when someone dies? Now, when someone dies, what is happening? Death is almost like a sleep. What happens to you when you sleep? You know, the most ironic thing is that we sleep every day, but we have never met our sleep. Every night, you go into your bed and sleep, and you have never met your sleep. If you meet your sleep, if you happen to understand your sleep, you will understand your death also. While sleeping, your whole consciousness, attention, your mind shrinks, and then one by one, you are shut off from the outer experiences and move inward into a void, a space. And then how you wake up in the morning, the same energy, then the same consciousness which was shrunk now starts expanding, which opens up and you wake up. And if you carefully observe the mechanism, the last thought that you get just before falling asleep becomes the first thought when you wake up. This gives you a clue of your reincarnation. The mind, which is full of different impressions, leaves this body, but the impressions remain with the mind like a balloon and waits for a proper situation for the same mind to come down. And when there is a copulation, when there is a proper womb formation, then it just draws, pulls that mind into that womb. And then a child is born. A body is gained. So it is the last thought is more important. Whatever you do throughout your life, at least in the last moment, your mind should be free and happy. If you are happy in the last moment before you leave the body, then you get a better body next time. It is almost impossible to get animal body after human birth. It's very rare, but still it is possible. If someone in the last moment keeps thinking about chicken, they'll be born in the poultry form. Because the last impression will be the strongest impression. And that impression in the mind will produce such a circumstance, a situation for the mind to take onto the body. You might have heard this tradition in England, also in Asia, China, India, also in some parts of Africa, often people would name their grandsons or great-grandsons the same name as the father, grandfather. No? George V, George VI. You know, this is also true. Because when they die, before dying, the most strong impression in their mind is of their children or grandchildren. And you would find many cases that the grandchildren do exactly the same way as your grandfathers or fathers or somebody in the family were doing. If it's a very well-knit family situations, they would act and behave like them, even though they are born several decades apart. Have you noticed, how many of you have experienced and noticed these things? This is very common, because then the children are the strongest impression in the mind of the grandparents, often. The strong impressions will create such a karma, because every impression is karma, but nothing to worry about it. Because karma is not a grain written on rock, it is fluid. And karma is always bound by time, because every action has only a limited reaction, not infinite. Suppose someone commits a crime, they get imprisonment in jail. That too, there is a time limit. You know, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, some time is kept. So every karma has only a limited sphere of its effect, good or bad. See, you do something good to people and then they'll come and thank you. You know, they are grateful to you as long as they are experiencing that effect of it. Do you see what I'm saying? Karma is that which propels reincarnation. Stronger the impression, the nature of next life could be that, predicted by that. There is one thing that can erase the karma, that is awareness. Knowledge, self-awareness, if you are aware of yourself, if you are in total love, then you are free from karma. When you are in total knowledge, total awareness, that is right, that is what the Buddhas and all the ancient rishis have said, coming out of the cycle of birth and death. That is, you have a choice. If you want to come, you can come. Okay, let me go there, play for some time, come back. That you are not bound by an impression, you are free, you know. See, a jailer and a prisoner could be the best example here. A prisoner is also in the jail, and a jailer is also in the jail. But the jailer has the freedom to go in and out and do what he wants, but not the prisoner. And what gives you that freedom is your awareness. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, addictions are nothing but very, very strong impressions in the consciousness. Whether it is alcohol, sex or drugs, anything, any addiction is like compulsion or compulsive behaviors. All is part of karma. And the karma is infinite. You know, because creation is not linear function, it is multidimensional. Truth is not linear, it is multi-dimensional. It's less spherical, you know. In a sphere, every point is connected with so many other points. If it is just a straight line, one point is connected with only two points, one back, one front. But in a sphere, a point is connected 360 degrees from all sides. That's why Krishna has said in Gita, Gahana Karmanogati means unfathomable are the ways of karma. There are many type of karma, individual karma and immediate family karma, the societal karma, and the time has a karma of its own too. You know, when a plane accident happens, people of all those same karma on the same day will be on the same plane. And if some are not in that, they will escape, walk out of the plane, though the plane has burned down. Have you heard of these stories? See, because there was something strong. They had that karma, yet their life was not finished. They walk out of that place. Survivors come out. And it is almost impossible to pin down which karma brings what effect at the deep level. So it is enormous. Of the three different karmas, Sanchita, the karma which we have brought with us, Prarabdha, the karma which is yielding fruits right now, and the Agami, the karma which we may incur in the future. Our Sanchita karma, the karma which we have as a storage tendency, can be burnt off. We can remove that, eliminate them. All the spiritual practices, prayers, service, loving people around us and the nature, meditation, all these aid in erasing the karma which we have acquired. The Sanchita karma, the acquired karma which we have brought with us. The Prarabdha karma which is already yielding result will have to be experienced. So it's Prarabdha, it's already run, on the run, you know. It's like you're on the car, it's already on the way, on the motorway. You cannot stop when you're on the motorway. You have to pull to the side to stop, right? You have a choice of changing the lanes, but you have no choice of exit when you have missed the exit. Do you see that? There is a freedom and yet there is no freedom. When you are in the freeway, suppose you have missed an exit. Now you have to go till the next exit. You have to be on the freeway. But you can change the lanes. You can go in the fast lane or slow lane. So there is such a freedom, yet there is no freedom in one sense. So with the Prarabdha karma, there is some freedom and there is no freedom. We have to experience those things, whoever it is. And then the third karma, that is Agami karma, which we might make in the future. Suppose you violate some laws of nature today, and in future you have to experience the consequence. Suppose you fast for 3 days, and the fourth day you just go and have French fries. And 4 days of French fries is good enough for you to fall sick. So this is Agami karma. You know if you do this, you are going to experience. Knowingly or unknowingly, that karma, that future karma, we do and we have to experience the consequence of it. That could be stopped. Right? If you steal today, you cannot say, oh, I have stolen today, but tomorrow nobody will catch me. The police can catch you tomorrow. You know, you cannot say, oh, I didn't steal today, it was yesterday. You know? You cannot say, no, I live in the present moment. No. You cannot say, that was a different person. I changed. I didn't do it. Okay, you suffer in that. So this is Agami karma, the karma which would yield its result in the future. Sometimes people ask, why bad things happen to good people? You are good today. Today you are very nice. You don't know what you did yesterday. So as you sow, so shall you reap. So those things give result in the future. Now today's karma, if we take care of it, and tomorrow it will not bother us. And every karma has a limited span of its results. Mainly 5 things come to us in our life from the Sanchita karma. From the karma you have acquired from the previous time, 5 aspects in life come. Birth and the place of birth. The parents you are born is from the past karma. Your education and line of education, degree of education. How much you acquire knowledge. And then the wealth, the source of wealth. Your longevity and mode of death. How you would die. These 5 things come from Sanchita karma, the karma we have acquired. Now, how rich we become, how much we can grow in our awareness, our marriage, children, and our social work, all this is Agami karma, the future karma. And the future karma you can associate now. What you gain now becomes your future karma. So you have certain degree of freedom to act now and acquire more karma. And you have certain fate, or you call it certain destiny, that you are provided with, that you cannot change. Do you see, you have any control where you are born? No, you are born in America, England, Europe, Australia, South America, South Africa, India, China. This has already happened and it is yielding the result to us. Generally, we can understand them like this. Yet I am saying there is always a possibility open. It is never a closed possibility. It's always an open possibility. And what makes it an open possibility is the presence of dharma, our nature, the human nature, which has freedom in it. And the second, prema, the love that we are. As I said, love is the common factor of the entire creation. If you see birds, there is love in the bird. If you see ants, there is love there. If you see anything, animate, inanimate, there is love permeating the whole creation. And your connectedness with that love takes you beyond birth and beyond death. You know, usually we say, don't hate anybody. You know why you shouldn't hate someone? When you hate someone, their impression becomes so strong in you, you become like them. Not for their sake, not to be compassionate to them. See, your hatred makes you like them. So often you become like the person whom you hate. And also you become like the person whom you love. Because love and hate, in fact, are the same. One standing upside down. Love is straight and hatred is the same thing upside down. Distortion of love is hate. And to get beyond love and hatred is through knowledge, through awareness. See, there is only one thing. This is another dimension to look at the reality. Like one thing is to see how many people are sitting here, 800, 900. And each head is coming out some thoughts, like a Coca-Cola bottle open, like bubbles come out of them. So each body is emitting bubbles of thought from it. But there is only one Coca-Cola, maybe with a different flavor or brand. It's the same drink. Can you see that? See, how many billion people live on this planet? 8, 9 billion people? 6 billion people? 6 billion people are living in this planet, and 6 billion heads and 6 billion thoughts every second. In this whole consciousness, see, 6 billion thoughts are coming up every second. Every second, it's not staying there. They come and go, another set of 6 billion thoughts. Some are in Chinese, some are in English, some are in French, some are in some other language, some are in Hindi, some are in Kannada. All different languages, all different emotions, all different colors. It's all happening in this moment. This moment has a mind of its own. And so many thoughts come in this moment and they vanish, just like the waves in the ocean. So why to give so much importance to what someone says, including what I'm saying now? So we go beyond the concept to a reality which is beyond thought, which is beyond words, which is beyond the opposite of love and hate. That is the real love. That something that is beyond hatred is true love. This is knowledge. This is jnana. And all the karmas, they dissolve in jnana, in knowledge, in awareness. Awareness has the strength to dissolve and destroy any karma. That frees you, it brings the freedom in you. Because you are one with that divinity, one with that totality of existence. And you live every moment in there. Anyway you are doing it.
In between incarnations, do you achieve cosmic consciousness? Are you aware of everything? Or are you at a certain level that you come back again to learn more?
Both possibilities are there. You don't learn anything there. In between incarnation, there is no learning. There is only resting.
One more question. I was wondering, when you had mentioned the last thought being so important to the next incarnation, what happens with people when they are violently taken away? What happens in a war, or what happens when someone is killed very violently, and that's their last impression? How does that impact their next life?
See, as I said, it is not linear, it is very complex. Of course, the last thought is a deeper impression is there, but there could be more deeper impressions. It's not that all those who are killed in the war have the same type of life. Not possible. All different.
A while ago, I had cancer, and so I dealt with my possible death for a while. And I was reading things. I was quite frightened by the Tibetan Book of the Dead. And I'm wondering, were there frightening things that were happening in the transition in the book? And I was wondering if that was going to happen to me, and it scared me very much, and I didn't finish the way. But then I hear other things from other people. I read about people who've died on the operating table, and they have this wonderful experience and don't want to come back. So, could you help me a little with this?
Yeah. I have to tell you, I have not read the book, Tibetan Book of Dead. I don't read books, first of all. Anyway, I have not read that book. What is in that book? Very frightening things. Demons and things came. Oh, no, don't worry about it. Nothing such thing. No, you won't be fried in the hell. You won't be fried like chicken. These are all not possible. Death all right. Is not any frightening. It is deep rest. And it's a loving space you are in, and deep rest. The only discomfort or uncomfortable souls are those who commit suicide. Because when a person commits suicide, what they are doing is, they are doing something very foolish. Suppose one has an anguish, and they don't know how to resolve this anguish in the mind, they destroy the body. By destroying the body, the anguish in the mind does not get destroyed. They are left with more anguish. For that, prayer, meditation, and just singing and being in love, these things will help. Anyway, that will not stay forever either. For some longer period of time, that will stay. It's like you are feeling cold and you are taking your jacket off. You feel more cold. So, but otherwise, nothing to worry.
My sister, who is a very beautiful, loving person, was killed by a car while she was walking across the street, but she was drunk. She was an alcoholic. Her son, who was 20 when he died, the same way in a car accident, not exactly the same, he was driving this time. But I'm wondering, when a person passes over and they are drunk, is it harder for them?
This we cannot say. All possibilities are there. It's all individual case. But you know one thing, there is nothing hard in life. And if you think something is hard, there will also be a love and strength that will come and help you. It's always there. The divine protection to you is always, always there in every situation. That's why I said the universe has not just karma, it has prema also, love also. There is a relief home.
Do you think there's a time when you work out all of your karma and you don't come back? You don't become reincarnated, you have ultimate awareness?
Yeah, then you have the freedom to come back. Then you come back.
And if you choose not to come back?
You know why? When you will choose not to come back? When you are scared about the world. When you know it's just a play field. Okay, let me go help out many people there. You would like to come back.
What are the concepts of hell and heaven?
Hell is all unpleasant impressions in the mind. That's painful impressions in the consciousness. Hell. Huh? Heaven is all the pleasant impressions in the mind, in the consciousness. There is not a place out there beyond the moon or somewhere. where you will be taken in and you'll be chopped off and then fried like chickens. No. There is no such place. Hell is created by our own mind, the pain and those impressions. And the heaven, our own conscience brings heaven. Our own conscience brings hell. Huh?
Do incarnations take place in another dimension besides Earth?
Earth is enough place to deal with us now, no? Possible, maybe, we don't know.
You said that humans are rarely reincarnated as animals, but do animals ever get reincarnated?
Yes. Animals do incarnate as human beings, definitely. If you see, especially if you observe the tribals in remote parts of this world, tribals, very innocent people, you will see they have no lines in their hand, one or two lines, no lines at all, very few lines. And very innocent, they don't have anger, jealousy, greed, and they, you know, it's amazing, their quality of consciousness, mind is very different. They are like the fresh lives immediately from the animal kingdom coming out, plants. Again, the fear in the animal is responsible for its next birth. Like a rat is always incarnated as cat. Because a rat is afraid of the cat. And if cat is afraid of something, whatever the fear is, like a snake incarnates as mongoose. Because the fear forms its greatest, deepest impression. So it takes on to that body. Same way, suppose a beast is killed by a lion or tiger, or it's scared by that, afraid of it, then it incarnates as that animal. That's why you would see often a tiger goes and jumps from the back. A lion or tiger never attack a beast from the front. Now a beast is killed, but it doesn't know who killed it. That's why though so many beasts are being killed, tigers don't increase so many. It's an interesting topic, huh?
I feel so very good in your presence. How does one maintain that awareness? I find it to be difficult at times. You know, at times I'm very successful in being in the state of awareness to where I monitor my thinking and monitor all these things, and then it just slips away for hours, and I say, gee, what happened? I thought I was monitoring my thoughts. So can you perhaps tell me what would be a good thing to be aware of and what to do?
You know, there is a story in India which is given as a caution to everybody that you have to be cautious about your alertness. You cannot say, oh, I have alertness and slip from alertness to unconsciousness. So there is a story, said a saint, an enlightened being, was sitting on a bank of a river. He was a very pious person. He was free, totally free. Then he saw a deer, and then he got attached to that deer. I mean, a deer was wounded, and so he took the deer and he band-aided that, and he was taking care of the deer. And it is said that next life he became a deer. Said this man, his compassion, his attachment to deer became so much that it is only one case, that only once this has happened, that an enlightened person became a deer. So this is a story of Jadabharata, this is very famous. It's said to the students as the last caution, the last word of advice. When they leave the school and go, said this is also possible. Yeah.
I was curious, a lot of the people around me suffer from fear and hatred, want to get beyond it, to love, but don't have the tools or the ability. Can you talk about some of the simple things that we can do to get to real love?
Yeah. See, negative emotion will bound to rise. They do rise. They're bound to rise. In life this happens unless you're so strong to see that everybody has bubbles. But in your day-to-day life, feeling of fear, hatred, jealousy, these things arise. When they arise, we do not know what to do about it, how to overcome it, how to get rid of it. You feel nasty inside and you wait for time to release you of that feeling. Sometimes it becomes more, and over a period of time it definitely reduces. Time definitely decreases any negative emotion. But neither at school nor at home, nobody ever taught us how to get rid of those feelings. Here comes the breath, secret of the breath. If you breathe out, if you breathe through it, then you will see in 10, 15 minutes, half an hour, you can get rid of all those emotions. Number one. Number two, this is the most powerful tool, the breath. Because breath is the link between the mind and emotions and the body, the intellect. Second is through the knowledge, deep meditation, deep meditation. Third is knowing this entire creation is made up of love and only love. And all these things are just ripples of emotions. They come and go, this awareness. But all this can happen when we work through our breath deeper. Yeah?
I would like to know your opinion. Is it a possibility to be physically immortal and not to die and drop the body? Is it a possibility?
First of all, if you have to talk about physical immortality, you cannot just talk on air. You need to have a solid proof, which you don't find. Buddha has died, Krishna has died, and all the people who spoke about physical immortality also died. There is no point in talking something which is not in our experience, which is not concrete in our experience, you know. You can guess, so maybe there is a possibility, but this only creates a hallucination in the mind, or it's a concept. But one thing I know I can tell you, it's possible to live long to 300 years. I have met people who have lived 300 years, 400-year-old person, but he also passed away recently, 4 years ago, 5 years ago. There was a gentleman who was nearly 400 year old, because the grandfather of the town where he was staying, he had seen that person the same way, and his grandfather also told him that this man was there. This was a Swami in the south of India in a village called Pullachi. We also have a videotape of him. See, this man is very old. He was speaking a language which was so old, nobody would understand even. That people considered him as a very holy man. People would go and just take his blessings. And a few of us visited him. A very old man. But he passed away too. So even that proof is not there. Physical immortality is possible.
Two questions. Number one, who made God? Number two, who taught him?
Okay, I'll answer this question if you tell me, where did a sphere begin? Huh? No, where did a ball begin? What is the beginning point of a ball? That's the question. The ball never begins anywhere nor ends anywhere. It just exists. If God was created, then it is no God. What is God? G-O-D. The generator, operator and destroyer. And what is this G-O-D, that which is permeating everywhere, a power that is permeating, like space, which is beginningless and endless. Where does the space end? Where does the sky end? Do you know? You know, children often ask you, what is beyond sky? They think it's a blue curtain, so something must be there on the other side. Where does the sky end? You know, in the Upanishads are the most valuable knowledge on this. You can say, what is God? Beautifully said, the space is God. Everything is born in the space, they remain in the space, they dissolve back into the space. Said, there are four characteristics of God. Satyam, it is truth. Truth means energy, the power. Jnanam, it is knowingness. There is knowingness in the infinity. Anantam, it is infinite. Don't ask me where is the end of infinity. If it has an end, it is not the infinity. That which is infinite, that which has knowledge, and that which is truth and energy, that is God. And that is what you are made up of too. Your body is limited, but your consciousness, close your eyes and see, it's infinity. There is no end to your mind. Your mind doesn't begin here or end here. It's beginningless, endless.
When you meditate, you're not supposed to think, right? How do you get the knowledge and the awareness if you don't think and it's just a blank space? How do you get it?
How did I get it?
Yes.
You know, everything comes out of blank space. Isn't it? If it's already filled with so many things, no knowledge would come up. Got it?
My question is, you've been saying something about tendencies, about being aware of tendencies. For example, with smoking, okay? So how do you quit the habit by being aware of the tendency? How does that work? That's what I didn't get when you mentioned that before.
Mm-hmm. How do you get over the tendency of smoking, for example? Is that the question? Now, the easiest thing would be, we want to do easiest things. We don't want to do anything difficult, right? Though it is difficult to get rid of it, we want to do easiest thing. And the easiest thing is take a vow of a definite period of time. Say, don't think I will never smoke for all my life. Say, okay, 40 days I am not going to smoke, come what may. Promise to God, okay, God, I am going to not to smoke for 40 days. If I do it, doom me. Finish me. When you take such a vow, okay, 40 days I am not going to do it, then it becomes easier. So you will wait. And then you will see, oh, I feel so fine, 40 days, I didn't smoke. Then, okay, if you really want to smoke, smoke for a week, and then again take another 40 days. This is the way to get rid of it, taking limited period of vow. Second, you know, it so happened, there was a lady who was smoking again, who came to me, Guruji, you have to help me, I am still smoking, I cannot even do this. I told her, okay, now you have a choice between cigarette and me. If you smoke cigarette, forget about, don't talk to me at all. Don't listen to my talks, don't come and meditate at all. Leave, drop meditation, pranayam, kriya, everything. And because she had so much love for the knowledge, for the kriya, all this, so she just dropped smoking. Though she was crying for a day or two, she thought it's so cruel that Pandiji would ask me to give such a promise, take a choice between me and him. But after the week, she was so happy that I said it so strongly, no, either you do this or that. Like there's someone who is very close to you, think that this is the choice. Either you like your husband or wife or the cigarette. Ask them to take a challenge from you, or your son or daughter. Because love can carry you through all habits. Love has such a power. Three things are there. One is practice. If you do practice, discipline, you can get through any habits which you don't want to have. Second, fear. Fear can get you through any habits. Fear of a disease or death or whatever, God getting angry at you. The third is love. I don't know any, if there is a fourth thing you can tell me.
What's the concept and understanding of angels and our relationship to angels?
Yeah. Just look up these chandeliers. Can you see them? Do you see all the colors in the chandeliers? You can take the picture of the chandelier, Scott. See, there is only one color light inside there. But when the light passes through those crystals, there are so many colors coming out, right? There is blue, there is red, there is orange. Seven colors. Just like the rainbows. The rainbow color is contained in the white light. But white light, when you see, you don't see any colors there. But when they pass through, they split and they appear to be different colors. The spirit or the divine consciousness is only one, but it has many attributes, many qualities, and some qualities, certain attributes, you can call them as angels. They are part of one whole. And I tell you, you are part of the light, and all angels are part of you. They serve you. I mean, it could be another topic by itself, some other time, talk on the angels. There is such a confusion about angels. We think it's something else, some other entity, somewhere out there, they come and do something to you. It is the projection of our own consciousness, our own life force.
There's this expression, old soul and new soul. He's an old soul and he's a new soul. And I never understood that because, I don't know, maybe you can explain it. Where, I mean, if somebody's a new soul, that means that they're just, boom, they're... From what you said before.
Uh-huh. Just like wine, you know, old wine, new wine. Older the wine, the more expensive it is, right? Isn't it something like that? But it's all relative terminology. We don't have to worry much about it. We just float into our meditation.
Shiva, 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 Shi